Good afternoon. Welcome back from the lab sessions. Hopefully all of you have been able to at least get familiar with the technologies and have been able to start creating a screencast. What we will do in this final session for this weekend synchronous two-day event is we'll actually continue a question and answer session. We'll do a flow transfer as usual, but instead of doing it like the usual, everybody raised their hand. What we will do first is look at a few questions that were there on chat and on the questions panel of AVU. We'll take those first and then you can do a hand raise. We also have a list of people who did a hand raise earlier today but were not there, but we ran out of time. So if those colleges have done a hand raise now, we will try to locate if they've already done it and we'll try to give them some preference. If you've already asked a question and if we have visited your college earlier today, we'll still keep you in the queue, but let's give a chance to those who have not yet been able to ask a question live. So let's take a couple of questions from the chat and questions window from AVU first. There were two related questions on Bloom's taxonomy. One is that sometimes levels that are next to each other, like apply and analyze or understand and apply, they seem very similar. You know, they seem to work. The specific question says that these two levels, it seems like we have to work on them together and what should we do? And this is perfectly valid. This particular taxonomy has 6 levels. There are some others which have different number of levels and so on. So it's more as a guideline. It really works reasonably well. But if you find that there is some activity at the borderline between two levels, make a choice. It doesn't matter too much. At the same time, if you feel that a particular question is kind of both at a high apply or low analyze level, just pick one, call it one and go ahead. So you don't have to worry too much about whether it's exactly apply or analyze or what. The reason the taxonomy is given is that when you frame your question paper or when you frame your assignments, please make sure that there are at least some questions at the higher order levels. Not all. Again, it's not recommended that all questions be at the create level. But what happens typically in university question papers is that most questions are in recall and understand level. So Bloom's taxonomy is one tool, one strategy we have to help us guard against that and to help us or to guide us to go to the higher levels. So it's perfectly fine if you're somewhere on the borderline, just pick one and go ahead. A related question is, are all 6 levels applicable to all topics? And on the face of it, I would say yes, because it's very rare. I haven't really come across a topic where it's impossible to write a question at the higher levels. And if you ask a broad question like, is it possible to write all 6 levels in a discipline or domain like management, then definitely yes, because that's very broad. So the point here is, the set of topics is limited to a few, and then you want the cognitive level or the thinking level to go from recalling the idea or remembering or stating or listing to applying to even creating some artifact or creating a process in that particular topic. So don't try to restrain yourself saying, oh, this Bloom's taxonomy is not valid for my topic. It has also been shown to be valid for a variety of levels, starting from school level to undergraduate to postgraduate level. So there's a lot of precedence. And finally, there are a lot of examples. So suppose you want to find questions on Bloom's taxonomy in electrochemistry. Okay, I just picked one. Google is one of your friends. You can just look at, try to search for who else has created questions in that topic. And now the resource that we are creating is also another place where you can look for such questions. So borrow what other people have done and hopefully you'll find it useful.
The remote center has asked that already the syllabus and the time schedule is crammed. So how will you motivate students to discuss? So a quick answer to it is that discussion forums are not done during the class time. Regularly it is all about offline discussions that happen. So it's like we are not saying that all discussion forums should be set up in a particular what do you say, software like Moodle or IIT Bombay X or something like that. But having a discussion forum, so some people have even put up discussion forums in Facebook. So all these students regularly check their Facebook and they are able to easily communicate with each other. So there are multiple technologies. So remember what we said in the morning. There are multiple technologies for which you can, with which you can actually facilitate this particular learning purposes of discussion. All you have to find is the right technology that is suitable in your context. So in recent days, we have lots of groups, even in IIT, joining in WhatsApp. So WhatsApp is now a very popular discussion medium where people can comment. Now with WhatsApp enabling file transfer, I think there are lots more people joining in this particular, many innovative teachers trying out various concepts. So for example, there is actually a research paper on the use of Facebook comments and Facebook as a medium for course delivery. I'll try to find it out and I'll try to post it in the IIT Bombay X platform in the coming days. But yes, so discussion forum limitation, find what works in your context. Discussion forums need not be in class, it can be outside classrooms. The only thing is that it has to be guided, it has to be structured. So make some kind of structure or give them focus questions to do the discussion. That will give you more results.
There are a few questions, admin or logistics questions on whether it's compulsory to upload the video from the lab for certification.
Okay.
Let JK speak about it.
So we have received requests, received queries where the screencast-o-matic was not working. Please note that the lab activity was meant for, creation, a significant amount of time is required for you to plan the scripting and all those things. The activity constructor or the PPT that was uploaded in Moodle actually helps you in doing that. Now the actual software delivery can be done at your own pace. This PPT has to be uploaded only on Sunday. There is an resource creation assignment that is going to come in this week. The due date for the resource creation is the week after next. So we'll provide with tomorrow's release, the resource creation assignment is specifically a creation of a screencast. So please note, both are two different angles. One is about the planning for the resource creation. The other one is the actual resource. So you will have to, this planning document is required so that we know that you did the lab work. So we generally, we will be looking at this assignment, but we'll be worrying more about the quality of the spoken tutorial or the screencast that you create in the coming week's resource creation activity, which will be done through peer assessment.
Okay, let's take a few questions from the centers. We'll actually skip over the first center because I think we had visited them earlier today. We will go to center 1316, Dronacharya College of Engineering.
Hello, good afternoon. First of all, I would like to thank you for such an interactive session. And my query is this, that can you post some links in resource files for week 2 as to use so that we can utilize this screencast in more effective way, as you have shown in your PPTs that there are certain handwritten and highlighters. So can you post some links where we can utilize these tools also? Thank you.
Sure. Yes, we'll be posting these resources in week 2. Week 2 in terms of content will be a light week because we'll be focusing more on the creation aspect of it. You have already familiar with the flipped classroom concept. So we'll not be bombarding you with too much content. The second week we'll be completely focusing on help videos, tutorials that help you in creating screencasts.
So all that will be available online so that you can create your own content.
Yeah. Good afternoon, sir. Yep. So I have one question which is going to come up, but I had the experience of doing other assessments of peers. So by using rubrics, I find some problem in the rubrics when we do assessment of peers. The assessment doing with rubrics, the problems come generally are the criteria given the rubrics are not matching with the assessment of the peer. So what to do in that condition?
Professor Jagpal, I completely understand where this is coming from, because I have seen the feedbacks during AT601TX exercise. But please note that the entire peer assessment exercise, there is some weightage for the peer assessments that you do. So there is a 10% weightage for the assessment that you are going to do, and there is the weightages we have adjusted such that it won't affect your total certification. So the detailed grading policy will be uploaded in a few days time. We have actually looked into all these problems that can come up based on our previous experiences. The purpose of this peer assessment exercise is primarily one, to ensure that all of you are familiar with the process of peer assessment and providing constructive feedback. And second, you are also familiar with the interface in Moodle that helps you in the peer assessment.
Let's go to center 1353.
Good afternoon, madam.
Yes, please go ahead.
Most of the participants in our remote center are from long distance. So 500 kilometers from this remote center. So maybe May 17th is too short for them to complete think, hear and share activity. So can you extend 1 or 2 days? Because all they have traveled to attend this face-to-face interaction, they take 1 or 2 days to complete this activity. So is it possible? Because of long distance participants are...
Okay. RVRG College, see, this being a workshop done at a larger scale, the pair and share, the think pair share activity is only an initial design that you have to do, okay. So, during this was posted on Thursday last week, and the last, the submissions, why we say that the submission is on 17th is because you need some more time for review also. So, the moment we extend the deadline beyond 17th, your assessment process is also going to be affected due to this. So I know though that it would be a bit hard, but I think the think pair share activities that you created yesterday, all you require is a minor refinement. See, the process, the focus of this is workshop is on creation. So even if the quality is bit at a lower side, you will receive appropriate feedback from your peers. So I would say that extending the deadline will be a little difficult, because we have so there is a direct notification that we cannot be too much, since it's a longer FDP, we cannot do too much extensions per week, because it is going to affect the successive week. So really sorry that we cannot do it. We have to be stern at one point or the other, and being an AICT workshop, we have to be really on our on top of this to ensure that participants submit.
Okay, and another question, sir, regarding that think pair share activity and out of class activity, both have to be on the same problem, or they can be from different problems or topics?
It could be from the same problem.
It's preferable if they're from the same topic and same problem, because that will give the complete flipped classroom experience. If you have it from different problems, maybe it will give you some practice, but you won't be able to use it together. So it's recommended that it is from the same problem.
Thank you, madam.
Yeah, center 1107.
I've got a question related to this peer and sharing. Now, we have got in first year subject like mathematics, discrete mathematics, random variable and stochastic processes. With how could this think, pair and share will be more useful in that subject? Because we get very less marks and the student did not clear the paper. They generally fail in that paper. How could TPS can help them?
So if you have questions in these papers related to proofs, for example, or related to derivations or problem solving, a think pair share can actually be used as a format to introduce these proofs and derivations. So normally a derivation or a proof is very long, and it's a little daunting for students to do the whole thing together. So if you as an instructor structure this derivation in two or three paths, where students begin by doing the think phase and so on and so forth, then at least they get introduced to how to begin doing these derivations. So if you feel that there are a lot of such problems, or maybe some other problem solving where it says calculate something or find out. So you have to look at the type of problems that come in the exam and construct think pair shares which are aligned to such problems.
I just wanted to know that there is a lot of stress on engineering subjects. So are there not many people from the other fields like arts, management, psychology or social sciences? Because whatever the questions are, they are also based on the same thing. And whatever examples you are giving, yeah, they are also related to the engineering papers. So yeah, how do we people from psychology or other subjects utilize this?
Yeah, we saw this such a question in the morning also. What we find is that both the participants, in terms of the departments they're from, as well as the colleges for this workshop and the previous workshops, are overwhelmingly from the engineering domains. In some of the workshops, they're explicitly for the engineering colleges, but it so turns out that I think even in this workshop, the demographic is like that. So we have fewer people, but what we will try to do on Moodle is to try to make cohorts. That if you have, you know, if you're from psychology, and we'll try to make a discussion forum or a forum only for people from that domain, at least it will be a more focused effort.
But I was thinking that it could be clarified that it is only for engineering, or if it is for arts and social, there could be more of participation from them, it would be more useful.
Okay, thank you. We'll note it and let the workshop team know. We'll see where the miscommunication happened here. 1039.
Like one of my suggestion is that most of us belong to management domain, and the examples which are being given in the study work and the course material you've been providing, they are not relevant. This is the first thing. Second thing is, talking about our teaching styles, the basic problem is that we work under a university and we have a class of 60 students. So talk about TPS, it won't be possible for us. So can you, in coming time, in coming weeks, can you please suggest some alternatives for that? Because if I am going to pair 60 students and I am going to give them 1 minute, it is going to take time. The time won't be sufficient because we have only 1 hour. So my humble request is, like, if you have any other alternative for this. So these are the two things. And third thing is, like, I've been thinking about this ICT. The more and more I use videos, the more and more I use technology, the human touch is going to disappear or vanish. Another my suggestion is that being we are all teachers, we are all, at some point of time, find ourselves under some stress. So like, you could suggest some things, some easy methods how to de-stress ourselves. So these are the three, four my basic concerns.
Okay, let us try to address your questions in a slightly different order. I'll take the think pair share question first. And the comment was that in a class of 60, it's not possible. So here I have a comment and a clarification. The comment is, it has been tried in multiple places, including by me personally, in classes as large as 250. So a class of 60 for me is actually small. I mean, normally we teach classes of 120, 150, 200 and so on. And we have done think, pair, share there. But the point is that we, in the share phase, it is not that every pair says what they have to say each and every time. So here you have to find some methods of getting the common answers. Even if you have 30 pairs, it's not likely that you will have 30 different answers. Most likely 30 pairs will give you something like 4 or 5 distinct answers. So you can start inviting responses in the share phase. And once you find a set of responses that you think are meaningful for that question, you can go ahead with that question. And when you repeat this activity, say the following week or 2 weeks from now, you can keep an eye and see, try to give chance to pairs which have not spoken up earlier. So the goal is not that every pair speaks up. So that was the clarification. But it has been tried and it's actually very doable even in large classes. In the pair phase, you just let people work with each other. The teacher does not have to intervene much in the pair phase. But in the share phase, they have to actually get these responses. There are so many other ways of doing it. You can have people write their answers on a piece of paper using marker or sketch pen and hold it up like that. You can post 4 or 5 common answers on the board and ask people to simply raise their hands if their answer matched after they do the pair phase. So you have to be a little creative in the share phase to get most people's responses.
Now here again, I have a very small concern because most of my students belong to management domain.
Yeah.
And being a management student, communication plays a very major role. They must know how to express themselves. So if I'm not giving them time to share, then I won't be able to concentrate on their communication part.
I think you can use other techniques. Your point about other techniques is also valid. We'll try to post a list. For example, if the goal is to improve their communication, then you can do something like a minute paper or presentations and so on. The primary goal of Think Pair Share is actually something similar to problem solving or multiple perspectives on a problem and so on. So, in fact, there are a lot of such strategies available. We will try to post some, and we'll also post sites where other strategies are available. So you can go and see which ones
that'll
are relevant.
That'll be nice.
About the domain of management and all, we've taken this up earlier. Unfortunately,
yeah,
we won't be able to give more examples, but what we can do is create groups or cohorts in Moodle where other people from this domain will respond to you and so on. The last question, I'm sorry about stress, that's completely out of scope of this conference.
I mean,
we are not experts here. Sorry?
Technologies. Madam,
I was talking about the human touch also.
So,
like the more and more I'm going to use ICT, the human touch is going to disappear.
I would.
So I'll have to have a very smart balance.
Exactly. So that is all what we said in the morning. So it's not just that technology is the solution for everything. You need a human brain behind the technology to clearly say what has to be done. And if you have this balance, then technology can provide you a lot of benefits. That's all what we said in this.
We are using technology as our tool for amplifying and improving the human touch here. The human being is central. The learning and teaching is still central. Technology is just the tool that helps us go even further. Okay, so that's been our approach and philosophy. It's never been to replace the human. Okay, let's take a question from 1266.
My question is, in recent or modern days course curriculum, there are several courses and each course is represented by a set of course outcomes. So, will it be possible to design the course outcome in the concept of Bloom's revised taxonomy? And if so, how it will be?
I'll just put a quick answer to this. Yes, it is possible to use course outcomes using revised Bloom's taxonomy. Basically, what you have to look at is within the course, what are the targeted objectives? So, in the videos you see, learning objectives are for a lesson. Now convert that into a course. So a course will have broad level objectives. So you will have to write broad level objectives which are both measurable and specific as is a standard learning objective. So this is a short answer to it.
Thank you. My second question is, we are so far discussing and studied about the revised Bloom's taxonomy under cognitive domain. Now, how much effective in teaching in case of affective and psychomotor domain, that is the other two domains of...
Okay. Yeah, so what you mentioned is actually valid, that the affective and psychomotor domains... So let me just give a brief, very brief one line or two line context here. There are similar hierarchies, not just for cognitive levels, but also for psychomotor domain and the affective domain, things like emotions and motivation and so on. It just has so happened that most educational efforts have focused primarily on the cognitive domain. It doesn't mean that the others are not important, but there hasn't been much work on the other domains. If you do consider them, in fact, it's really good thing and you can share with us how you use them and so on. It's just that the cognitive domain has received a lot more focus from educators in the last several decades.
No, I have to select a video for flipped classroom. So may I choose the video from YouTube which I created by Skinomatic?
Sure, you can.
What will be the length of the video?
See, ideally it should be short, under 10 minutes, that is preferred. One guideline, so show it to a peer from your own domain before uploading it in YouTube, so that you will know exactly what kind of feedback the peer gives you.
There are two assessments. So there is the assessment of creating the video. So I can use the video in the past assessment.
I'll just clarify the question. Is it that the YouTube video that you have selected is already a screencast video that you created?
No, sir. I will create for the assignment, for the next assignment.
Yeah, so you can create that, no issues. No issues for that.
Center 1146.
My question is regarding the flipped classroom. So far we have done two flipped classroom activities. One is Professor Seeder's video, then followed by the first day videos, first day presentations, then Professor Sahana Muthi's videos and today's presentations. My question is exactly about the perception of the student who is present inside the class. There is a notion that when the class starts, there is a notion that the students already know the topic, and there is a possibility that he could lose interest and possibly curiosity. How could I handle this?
Okay, so this question has come up in a different fashion earlier, that if we used a flip method, the students have watched a video or heard a podcast, seen a screencast, read a book, and they may have the perception that they already know the topic, so, and they may lose interest. The idea here is that the in-class activities are maybe on the same topic, but the type of activities you do are not similar to the videos. In fact, it's recommended that you do a lot of application, real-life context, design problems. The in-class activities have to be chosen carefully. They have to be given thought to make them more interesting and relevant to students. So if students have this perception in the first week, you can tell them, you can actually discuss this with them and tell them that, look, the in-class activities are merely on the same topics, but they are nothing like the videos. If anything, they're about applications and harder applications. And once they do one or two such in-class activities, the students will realize that they need to watch the videos to be able to solve it. But it's not that they've already done the type of problems that are being done in class. That's why we recommend that you don't do routine problems, that you don't only do clarification in class. You can do some clarification, that's required. But if you do only routine problems, or if you repeat what was in the videos, then your concern will be a lot more valid. Okay, let's go to Center 1313, over to you.
First of all, I would like to thank you for this highly productive interactive section. And actually, one simple question. How does blended learning can be used for slow learners?
Okay, yeah. Let me just try to answer this. The question is how blended learning is useful for slow learner. So blended learning means there is some out of the class component, which will be typically online or some videos or something like that. And there will be an in-class component. So for slow learners, you can provide them with sufficient materials which they can go through at their own pace, and also with even more description. Let's say there is a video which talks about a concept. On top of that, you can create small questions like the learning by doing activity and ask them to do it step by step. So what happens over here is, as a slow learner, they have the time to watch the video and also practice these concepts before coming to the class. So within the constraints, what you are actually providing them is more help out of the class, but with very carefully thought out and curated activities.
You can also include additional discussion forums for people who have additional doubts. So you can exploit the online part completely to give extra help to whoever requires it. Okay, Center 1082.
Good evening, ma'am. Good evening, sir. My question is related to think, pair, share activities. Ma'am, almost all of us from our remote center have submitted the have done the submission, and now it's coming as edit submission. I just want to get it clarified that unless and if we are not doing any editing, does it mean that is it accepted as whatever we have submitted as it is till till 17th?
Yeah, so the question is, when you submit into Moodle, the peer assessment activity in Moodle, after your submission, there is this box which says edit submission. So what does that mean? So this is repeating the question for all other participants. So you have time till 17th to make some corrections or modifications based on the face-to-face interaction sessions that you have attended on the past 2 days. So that is why we have kept this interaction session in between and gave this particular assignment as the first assignment. So if you don't edit, if you are fine with whatever you have submitted, during the assessment phase, your submission will go to the peers and they will grade it as it is. At this point, you have the flexibility to make any small corrections that you want to make based on the knowledge that you gained over the past 2 days.
One more question, sir. This is under submission phase. Now the next phase will be assessment phase. Now this assessment, like let's say my topic, my area of work is different. My area, whatever submission I have done, that is related to some other topic. So the assessment would be done by whom? Like it's from the related areas of people, or it is like from? Like, I'm not getting like who will be doing the assessment?
Yes. So the question is, what if I am from a domain, let's say from arts? So will a computer science guy get my assessment, or will I have to evaluate a computer science assessment? So the answer is, at the start of the week activity, you have selected a group, a domain. So all the people within this domain has been clubbed such that they will have more or less similar topics. So for example, computer science and IT were clubbed together, arts, most of the arts and humanities, arts, humanities and management were clubbed together because we thought they will be understanding each other's subject a little better. Similarly, electrical and all the allied departments to electrical were allied into one group. So you will be getting submissions from your domain only, the broad domain. So you will not get from some other domain which you don't completely know. But even in this case, since there are some overlaps in some scenarios like arts, management and humanities, there might be some cases where people are not familiar, but over there we actually ask them to look at the way the entire activity is constructed, and you can actually take help of discussion forums. You can ask people who are from this particular subject on how to evaluate such a TPS activity. So discussion forums have been kept in IIT Bombay X so that you can take help from people from other domain. So next week we will be having dedicated domain wise discussion forums. Like I showed you, week 3 we will have 5 or 6 different domains, and you can all start discussions within your domain. So this is what we mean by cohort discussions.
Yeah, one more question I am having. This is related to the quiz submissions. Like most of the like one or two quizzes may be having all the options, all the answers are correct for the that particular quiz. And suppose if we have selected one or two out of that, how the grading would be done?
It will be evaluated as a wrong answer, because all the options, so we have given hint that whichever options have more than one correct answer, we have provided a hint. So if you look at the questions, you will see that hint.
The answers would be all four. Then how the grading would be done?
So you will not get marks for that. You will have to select all four. There are no partial answers.
Yes. Center 1228.
Hello, madam. This is from Laila. We are talking. I have a simple question to ask. Most of the faculties, irrespective of their university affiliation, most of them have a handwritten notes of the content, and you are stressing on videos from YouTube. Can we use those handwritten content for our videos that we generate? That's the first question. And second is that most people, as of we're talking, we find that most people is asking how we can incorporate our syllabuses into this online blending. I have a suggestion to make. If you can frame your questions in think, share, and paraphrase in all the three phases, if you can put your university questions into that, I think people, both as a faculty and the student, will be comfortable with output that they are expected, both in the university as well as in their regular understanding.
Okay, maybe let's address your two questions first. Regarding your second question, what you're saying is absolutely right, that the think, pair, share is only a framework. It's like the structure or the skeleton on which you, or into which you have to put in the content and the type of questions that you are comfortable with. It's not that the think, pair, share tells you what the question itself should be. It's merely a framework. So take your content, take the type of questions that you give in your exams or that your university suggests, and then morph them or frame them according to the think, pair, share framework, and then use them in the class.
So I think the question was, can the handwritten notes be used for the out of class? It's a perfectly valid way. So we said that print materials, it has been a popular out of class activity. The name flip classroom became a buzzword just recently, but previously our arts and humanities teachers usually did the flip classroom, where they gave notes to students to read outside and then discussions happened inside the classroom.
So handwritten notes are perfectly valid and fine, but you can also ask yourself how interesting they will be for students and whether students are really likely to go through them. Given what is called this generation or digital generation and all, if you can augment your handwritten notes, for example, by some material that's available on the World Wide Web, you may have a higher chance that the student actually goes through it. So that's a trade-off you have to make.
Good evening, madam. This is regarding the domain, where I belong to a domain, English, where I don't have any participant in this RC. But when you ask for the group discussion, group activity, I have joined to another domain and we did the group work. And when I am going to do my individual submission, I'll be getting into my own domain. And towards the end of the course, in the group activity, I'll get into the other group where I will not be in my domain. Will this affect the grades you give to me personally?
No, it should not affect the grades in any manner. In fact, hopefully once you submit your assignment in your domain, we will find at least somebody else in the English domain should be available within the 100 and odd RCs who should be able to give you some feedback, if not in the assignment itself, in the discussion forum. So,
yeah, and one more thing is, we'll put this request to the workshop logistics team. And consider yours, because this scenario might happen. Within remote center, it will not be possible to create a team because of the domain constraint. So will such cases be allowed offline or asynchronous teaming up? That is what technology actually, for this FDP, since we are using ICT, I think your case is a genuine case and it should be considered for asynchronous team building. So we'll definitely put this request into the workshop logistics team. You will soon hear from them.
Because, yeah, that's my question, sir. Because for the peer activity, maybe in the discussion forum, I can get answers. I can share my information, but not in the group activity. So again and again, I will be getting into different domains, like my domain individually.
Okay,
and the
we'll
group
take
activity
your request.
Into another domain.
We'll consider your request. Thank you. 1263, please go ahead with your question.
Yep. This is regarding the PPT you have requested on today.
Yeah.
The name of the PPT is Day 2, Game 1, Video Creation Lab.
Correct.
So over there, we have understood the basic requirement that you need to create a screencast video. And we have also checked the software, Screencast-O-Matic. The specific question is, in the PPT, there are a couple of slides where there are blue text And I believe that these blue ticks are to be replaced with our own tick.
Exactly.
Now the question is, should we submit only the change slides or the full slide pack with our changed content?
Okay, so if you can just submit your changed slides, that is the best possible. But if you find that very cumbersome, deleting slides and other activity, you are free to submit the full set of slides. We wouldn't mind that.
It's fine. We'll be sharing only the chain slides. Yep.
Thank you.
Okay. Center 1116.
Good evening, sir. Actually, sir, there is a question regarding the flipped classroom activity constructor, which we had to submit, which was given as lab activity yesterday.
Yes.
And which we need to submit. In that, there is a slide in which we have to post some URLs.
Yes.
Video URLs.
Yes.
And below that, there is a post called as license of video, in which we need to provide resource license used. What we need to do there, it is not clear to most of us. There is another question. Actually, it is an observation with suggestion rather than a question. It has been observed when we have seen the lab activities of yesterday as well as today, that most of the things which we need to do in lab activity, they are not very clear. So we need, for most of the time, just trying to figure out what to do. So there is a suggestion that for the coming face-to-face interactions, it will be better if you can provide a clear-cut, step-wise slide which can be submitted at your Moodle or whatever platform, so that we can understand in advance what to do in a clear-cut manner.
Sure.
As today also, we spent about 4-5 minutes just figuring out what to do. So it is not very effective. Thank you.
Okay. Point 2 has been noted and has been taken into consideration. Regarding point 1, so this is regarding licenses of resources that you get from web. So typically, so you know about copyright issues and other possible legal problems associated with materials. So we are, in this workshop, we are training you to use open source resources and open Creative Commons licenses, such that you won't have any legal problems in using the resource in your classroom or at any place. So the license that you see, we advise that it could be a Creative Commons license. So if you are selecting videos from YouTube, so if you click on show more, over there it will say the license type. So most of the videos are standard YouTube license, which follows the, then you will have to look at the licensing agreements of YouTube. It will be, it might have some copyright issues, but some other resources have been mentioned as Creative Commons license. So Creative Commons license will assure that this content can be used by multiple people without too much of issues. Just look at the wordings of the Creative Commons license. Some might say Creative Commons non-commercial. So it just means that you are free to use it, but do not use it for commercial purposes. So that's all what you have to take care of. Okay. Yeah. There is another question from the back. Yes.
Yes, sir. There is two links which we need to follow. One is IIT Bombay X and other is Moodle. Mm-hmm. And many times there is issue in shuffling between these, and sometimes it becomes difficult with which part will be on which side. So it's a suggestion that please give a mutual link on each of this page, so that we can easily shuffle between these two links. This will be very useful.
Yeah, so this suggestion is duly noted, and I think a clear-cut message was given right at the start of the workshop. All the submissions where you require to upload files, only those will be there in Moodle. So IIT Bombay X will not have any file submissions. So whenever there is an activity which require you to submit a file like a PDF or the PPTX, then you have to go and look in Moodle. So all the peer assessment activities which contain some file submissions or peer review activities, we use Moodle. The place where we use IIT Bombay X is for multiple choice questions and videos. Only these will be available in IIT Bombay X. This was there in the starting, the readme first document which was circulated with the start of the course. So if you have not seen it, please have a look at it. So just to clarify, file submissions and peer assessment in Moodle, online quizzes and videos in IIT Bombay X.
Yes sir, there is a question related to ungraded activities. Okay, what role does ungraded activities plays in getting a certificate?
Okay, submissions in ungraded activities is a must, like the lab sessions and other places, because this ensures ungraded activities act as your attendance. Supposing, so this being an online activity, it is doubling up as your attendance also. So you might have understood something from the lab, but you have actually tried and did it. That is what ungraded activities actually mean. They will not have any, what do you say, mark wise weightage towards the overall certification.
Is there any deadline for ungraded activities?
Yes, for each submissions we have provided deadlines. So the lab submissions, whatever week 2 submissions, all submissions are due by May 22nd.
We'll take 2 more centers and then we'll wind up the day. 1305.
Sir, I want to ask that we have to use the screen automatics tool for this movie making.
So screencast-o-matic is one example of screencast creator. You, if you are familiar with some other tools, you can, you are free to use it.
Automatics tool or other equipment tool for.
Sure. You are free to use it.
Or other equipment tool for movie making or.
Yeah, you can use either Screencast-O-Matic or any other tool if you're familiar with other tools. Any is fine. Center 1148.
Yes.
Ma'am, my question is that wiki activities, what we have done, like wiki portfolio and all. So, sir, my suggestion is that why not we can make that profile what we have done over there in a public domain, so that our students as well as anyone who can wanted to see that will be visible, sir.
So one of the idea is that we are going to, so there is a thought that you are free to publish it in open domain. That is why we put every activity in open education resource or Creative Commons. As part of the workshop, we want you to practice all this, and once the workshop duration is over, you are free to take the content and put it in an public domain.
Sir, one more thing, sir. We are using screencast video recording, yes. But what the problem we are finding over there, sir, when we wanted to record both screen as well as video, we are unable to, because their sounds is not coming so clear and all. So is there any other options so that we can, there is alternative process where we can record that video as well as our screen also?
So typically this happens if the processor, maybe processor restrictions, but Screencast-O-Matic, the normal version traditionally allows this to happen without much hassle. Try to do it in individual laptops. You might be able to get a better, video plus screen this integration together. The other tools, open tools, most of them are proprietary. As in, you will have to pay and get the software. Screencast-O-Matic at least provides free software for 15-minute videos. That is why we put up the Screencast-O-Matic over there. One other possibility is Jing, which gives only 5-minute videos. So 5 minutes might be too hard for many of the participants when they start off. So that is why we did not focus more on Jing. Rather, we gave Screencast-O-Matic, which has a much more vibrant community.
Sir, in Moodle, we have one option, question answers.
but we are not able to find, I mean, we have to post that questions, or I mean any link over there to post our questions and answers. So why not? The Moodle account, recently we have added a tab, question answers.
It's not in Moodle. Q&A tab has been added to the IIT Bombay X specifically for this answering unanswered questions that came up during AVU. So we might not have received most of the centers, maybe due to time constraint, or we might have overlooked some questions. So for answering those, we have used that tab in IIT Bombay X.
Okay, we'll take one last question. Center 1341.
It is question related to the YouTube videos related. Madam, it is allowed to upload the video collected from YouTube for the PPT. And second one is the related to peer assignment, madam, peer assessment. When to be collected for these peer assessment related videos, and when you need to upload? These are the two.
Okay. Question number one, are YouTube videos allowed in the selected videos? Yes. You are referring to the yesterday's lab assignment, if I am not mistaken.
So we uploaded to with PPT.
Yes. So yes, YouTube videos are allowed. Ensure that they have appropriate licenses, because sometimes most of the YouTube videos you may not be able to use extensively. So just beware of the license that is there. Regarding peer assessment of videos, it is going to come as next week's task. Currently, this is peer assessment of think pair share activity. That is, the think pair share activity has to be submitted on 17th, and the reviews are due by 22nd. The next set of activity will be creation of the screencasts, which we will release on Thursday. So you will get total again 5 days to submit and 5 days to review.
Sir, so my doubt is, actually my domain is computer science and applications. So could I allow to submit the problem from other domain?
Okay. Can you give an example of other domain?
Other domain means like mathematics.
So you are allowed to in principle, but the thing is, if you are not teaching a course on mathematics next semester or so, it may not be very useful to you. So we highly recommend that you upload questions and assignments based on some course that you are teaching now or you will be teaching shortly.
But whatever the things I am going to be teach to my course, the mathematics is existing as one of the subject.
Then it's fine. So if mathematics is relevant for you, then you are free to do it. So make sure that you join the cohort of mathematics and not computer science. And in your further groupings also, ensure that you belong, you are there with a group of mathematics teachers within your RC.
It's okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. So that brings us to the end of this 2-day synchronous sessions. We did some interactive activities in your classrooms, some labs and some question answer interactions. We will continue the rest of this FDP the next 2 months or so. You know what is coming next week, the next 2 weeks. And if you have further questions, for example, if we haven't been able to get to you in any of the Q&A sessions, or if you have any burning questions, there are 2 or 3 places where you can post it. One is that you can still post it in the chat window for the next 10 minutes or so. We will be collecting questions in the next 10 minutes. And a much better place to post is the discussion forum that is there on IIT Bombay X, because it's not only the instructors who are looking at it, but also your peers, your colleagues, and so on. So these are 2 places where you're welcome to post, and hopefully the rest of the community will also respond. So hope you have a very productive rest of the program. And good evening to you all.